India remained as it is. India is neither called as a Hindu country also. It was called as a secular country. So, and Pakistan was called as a Muslim country. So in this way, the separation happened. And there was a lot of communal violence. There's a lot of communal violence and there's a lot of just a minute. And unrest in the in India. You will see here on the streets people are fighting. I got these photos from internet of the Indian freedom struggle. And many people started traveling from India to Pakistan, and some Hindus from Pakistan started migrating to India in seek of security and shelter. So you will see in this train thousands of people cramming inside and moving from one country to another country. So Srila Prabhupada, in this situation, he writes an article, and in that article he says like this: our independence movement was started by Mahatma Gandhi for uniting all the different sections of the people. But actually the result was that instead of being united, India was partitioned. And the partition became so poisonous that formerly there was only sporadic Hindu-Muslim riots in some places, but now there was organized fighting between Pakistan and Hindustan. So actually we were not being united, we were being separated. So this is what Prabhupada says here. So this partition between India and Pakistan was a bigger blow to India, because previously Prabhupada used to say that Hindus and Muslims will come together and they will be happy, and in fact they'll go to each other's homes and they will exchange gifts and such kind of, and even in festivals Hindu Muslims will come together and sometimes and celebrate. So that kind of culture was there, and Hindu Muslim fights were very rare, very rarely. But after partition, after independence, you will see so many riots and wars. You will see Kargil war and India-Pakistan war, many times it happened. So that organized fighting started. That's what Srila Prabhupada is telling here. And Prabhupada says, we have seen in 1947 Hindu-Muslim fighting. One party was Hindu, the other party was Muslim. They fought and so many died. And after death, there is no distinction who was Hindu or who was Muslim. The municipal men gathered them together in piles to throw them somewhere. They fought in Bagh Bazar. There were heaps of dead bodies. And when it is a dead body, nobody could understand who was Hindu and who was Muslim. Simply, it was to be cleared from the road. So very interesting observation Srila Prabhupada is making here, that when we are alive, we think that we are Hindu or Muslim, and people, they generally fight with each other. But when we die, there is no distinction but whether we are Hindu or whether we are Muslim, right? It is a dead body, and all the bodies are taken in a truck and dumped somewhere, and there is no distinction between Hindu Muslim. So Srila Prabhupada is exposing this ignorance of people, that how we should not be bodily conscious. So this is called as bodily consciousness. Yasyatma buddhi kunapetri dhatuke swadhik kalatra dishu bhauma ijjadi yattirta buddhi shalilena karihichit janeshu abhigyeshu sayeva gokhara. Such a person who is considering his body to be himself, or a person who is considering his place of birth to be holy, because he is born in India, India is holy, or somebody is born in America, America is holy, like that he thinks. That's called Bhauma Ijjadi, that the Bhumi where he is born is worshipable. Swadik Kalatradishu. And one of the things that people who are connected in my family, they are mine. That is also a big illusion. Thinking that I am body is an illusion. And thinking that I am the things connected to my body, they are mine. That is a bigger illusion. So that is called Moha and Mahamoha. So Moha and Mahamoha are very sign of ignorance actually. Only when we think that I am Krishna's, that is true knowledge. If we think that I am belonging to somebody or this material world, that it is ignorance. So Prabhupada is exposing this ignorance. Such a person who is having this consciousness that my birthplace or my birth caste is the best, he is called as a gokhara, cow or ass, because they are in animal category, so they are ignorant animals, so that's why they are called as gokharaha. So Srila Prabhupada is telling this. You can see in this photograph, people are dead and some scavengers are coming and picking them up and dumping them somewhere. All this happened. Once His Grace Vibha Krishna Prabhu was sharing that, I asked him, Prabhu, how come you are in Bangalore? Then he said, actually we are Sindhis and we were actually belonging to Pakistan and that kind of near Afghanistan area. But when this partition happened and their ancestors, they migrated to India with just one bag, that's all. One bag of clothes, that's all. And they came and settled in Bombay, and from there they came to Bangalore. And since then they have been in Bangalore. And he was telling that those times are very painful when the partition was actually happening. So coming to the point of the unknown friend, Avijnata. So the word Avijnata or the unknown friend comes in Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 4, in the section of Puranjana. There is a description of Avijnata. So there Puranjana, when Narada Muni is telling a story of Puranjana to Prachindya Parishad, there he uses the word Avijnata. He says that there was one person called Puranjana, he was searching for happiness everywhere in this world. He went to mountains and valleys and different lands, but nowhere could he find happiness. Because he had forgotten his friend Avijnata. And forgetting his friend Avijnata, he was roaming all over in the world. And finally he came to a tract of land which was on the southern side of the Himalayan mountain. And that was his land or a city with 9 gates. And he entered into the city of 9 gates and he became so happy seeing the facilities in the city of 9 gates. And the city of 9 gates is nothing but the human body which has got 9 gates, right? All the 5 year, 6, 7 and 2 below. So these 9 gates, human body provides utmost facilities. And there in that city of, in the city of 9 gates, he became attracted to Puranjani, which is compared to pious intelligence. And along with pious intelligence, Puranjana started enjoying the city of 9 gates and spent his time. But even after enjoying so much in the city of 9 gates, still he could not find happiness. He could not find the ultimate satisfaction. So finally, it is a long story, but there was an attack by Chandavega and different diseases, and the body was put on fire, or the city was put on fire, which is called Maranajwara. And Puranjana was forced to leave from that city, and he ran away. And then he took birth in a woman body, because he was attached to his wife. Because Puranjana was attached to his wife, that's why he became in the next life a woman whose name was Vaidarbhi. But fortunately, she got a devotee husband whose name was Maladhvaja. And Maladhvaja being very spiritual, he also gave a lot of spiritual credits to Vaidarbhi. So this is the beauty of Krishna consciousness. If the wife faithfully serves the devoted husband, the wife automatically gets the spiritual credits of the husband without any separate endeavor. So that's the benediction given. So when Maladeja quit his body, Vaidarbhi also wanted to quit her body and enter into the fire. So you will see in this photograph here, so she is Vaidarbhi, and behind you will see that Chita is burning, that is Maladeja. They had gone to the forest as Vanaprasthas, leaving the kingdom, and Maladeja sat in meditation and he passed away. And here Vaidarbhi, in separation from the husband, she was a chaste lady, so she wanted to enter the fire with the husband and also go back to Varad. But at that time, one Brahmana comes. So you'll see this Brahmana here. And this Brahmana says, "Hey Vaidarbhi, do you remember me? I'm your old friend. Since long, I have been your friend, but you have forgotten me. Can you please remember me? Who am I?" So like this, he tries to put a puzzle, but Vaidarbhi could not understand. Then Brahmana gives wonderful instructions to Vaidarbhi that how you should take association of devotees who are like swans. That's why that swans are painted here, and with lotuses and a calm lake. So by taking the association of devotees and practicing the path of bhakti, you can attain your true friend, who is Paramatma. Actually, that Brahmana was none other than the Supreme Lord Paramatma, who had come in the guise of a Brahmana to guide Vaidarbhi back to Godhead. So in that section, this unknown friend is coming. So that's why the title of this chapter is also put as unknown friend, because Prabhupada is also playing the role of an unknown friend for Mahatma Gandhi. So the unknown friend of the world, Srila Prabhupada. Because until 1965, nobody knew who is Srila Prabhupada. He was silently staying in Vrindavan, writing books, trying to do some preaching in India, but the whole world did not know the glory of Prabhupada, how he is a true friend of the entire world, because he wants to connect all the living entities to Krishna. So who is a true friend? A person who connects us to Krishna. He is a true friend. So Srila Prabhupada is a true friend, and especially of Mahatma Gandhi. So at that time, in 1947, Mahatma Gandhi was busy with the political moves. Of course, he was successful in driving away the British. But after the British went away, there was a bigger problem which they had to encounter. So I'll read this section from the chapter. So Gandhi's secretary, Pyarelal Nair, described Gandhi at this time as the saddest man one could picture. So you'll see here Gandhi is sitting very sad, deeply thinking, because there is a reason for this. The reason is the men he had led in the struggle for Indian independence, Jawaharlal Nehru, Vallabhbhai Patel and others, had taken the leadership of the nation. Okay, so the people whom he had led, they became the leaders, but he had no position. He was not a leader. And Gandhi, with his doctrines of non-violence, unity, agrarianism, was now at odds with them in many ways. Because Jawaharlal Nehru, being an atheist, he had his own idea of economic development. He wanted to build factories and bring reforms in the industrialization. And hardly there was any talk about co-protection or Bhagavad Gita. And Gandhi's life, he has read Bhagavad Gita in detail, right? In fact, one of my inspiration initially was Mahatma Gandhi only. In my school days, I had read his book, My Experiments with Truth, where it tells about how, as a child, he had some experiences, and later on, he had a very spiritual calling at the age of 36, and he renounced his family, and he took to the path of celibacy and renunciation at the age of 36, and he spent a lot of time studying Bhagavad Gita, and chanting the names of the Lord. He did that, but somehow that political tinge was still there. He was into politics. So he feared he was becoming an anachronism. His former colleagues admired him but rejected his leadership. They did not follow him. They accepted him as the father of the nation, but they did not follow his ideology anymore. You will see there was no talk of non-violence, nor co-production, nor agriculture, or khadi. But there was talks about power and talks about industrialization. His former colleagues admired him, but rejected his leadership. All his programs, Hindu-Muslim unity, non-violence, upliftment for the poor, although praised throughout the world, were failures in the India of 1947. So it was at this time that Srila Prabhupada was staying in Kanpur, and he was trying to meet some people, and he was trying to establish the League of Devotees in India, right? So, and he was trying to preach to the best of his capacity. And it's at that time he gets a desire in his heart. Now Gandhi is so famous, he is so influential now, and he has already got so much credentials. He is also a fan of Bhagavad Gita, he reads Bhagavad Gita, but somehow or the other he doesn't have a guru. He has not accepted a spiritual master. That's his mistake. So let me write to him, and let me try to impress upon him the importance of Krishna consciousness and accepting a bona fide guru for practicing Krishna consciousness. So Srila Prabhupada takes his pen and writes a letter to Mahatma Gandhi, which is a very, very, very revolutionary letter. And some of the devotees found it and they published it in Leelamrit. It is very, very inspiring. Let us try to read and understand the mood of Srila Prabhupada in trying to convince the leaders about this path of Krishna consciousness. You will see Prabhupada is always focused on leaders. If one leader becomes a devotee, then he can influence thousands of people. That was his conviction. So he didn't leave anybody. He wrote to Rajendra Prasad. He wrote to the Vice President of India. He wrote to Jawaharlal Nehru also, because Nehru was a customer in Prabhupada's pharmacy in Allahabad. Nehru's family, they used to come to Prabhupada's pharmacy and purchase medicines. And Prabhupada will say he was always fan of English medicines. He was fan of English medicines and English dogs. That was his. So Prabhupada knew about the leaders of India also. And Prabhupada writes to Gandhi. Prabhupada writes to governor of UP. Prabhupada later on writes to him also. Lal Bahadur Shastri, he meets. Prabhupada meets Indira Gandhi also. Even in America, Prabhupada is writing to top people, trying to convince them and impress them about the path of Krishna consciousness. So it's very easy to propagate Krishna consciousness with political or leadership support. It becomes easy. Just like one Ashoka accepted Buddhism and immediately it spread like wildfire. Similarly, one leader accepts Vaishnavism, it becomes very easy to propagate Krishna consciousness. So that is the mode of Srila Prabhupada. So here in this letter, so Prabhupada starts writing. My dear Mahatmaji, please accept my respectful namaskar. So he begins the letter by telling, I am your unknown friend, but I had to write to you at times. And again, although you never care to reply them. See, Prabhupada sent some letters before also, but there was no replies. So Prabhupada is writing again. I sent you my papers back to Godhead, but your secretaries told me that you have very little time to read the letters and much less for reading the magazines. I asked for an interview with you, but your busy secretaries never care to reply this. Anyway, as I am your very old friend, although unknown to you, I am writing to you in order to bring you to the rightful position deserved by you. As a sincere friend, I must not deviate from my duty towards a friend like your good self. See, Prabhupada is writing so personal letter, with great eagerness, earnestness and concern. Because Gandhi is in the fag end of his life now, almost touching 80 years. And he's old, but still he is not Krishna conscious. He is politically conscious. He has not retired from political life. Although superficially he has accepted the robe of a renunciate, but he has not yet accepted the mood of a renunciate. I tell you as a sincere friend that you must immediately retire from active politics if you do not desire to die an inglorious death. So this is a prediction. You can take this statement as a prediction that if he doesn't retire from politics, then his own people will kill him. And that's what happened within few months. You have 125 years to live as you have desired to live. But if you die an inglorious death, it is no worth. And in Srimad Bhagavatam, it is also said that what is the use of living a long life? Better a moment full of Krishna consciousness is more valuable than a long life like a tree. So Prabhupada is echoing that point here. The honor and prestige that you have obtained during the course of your present lifetime were not possible to be obtained by anyone else within the living memory. But you must know that all these honors and prestiges were false in as much as they were created by the illusory energy of Godhead called the Maya. Hare Krishna. Prabhupada is very straightforward, frank in expressing the truth. Right? Generally, when somebody becomes very successful and famous like that, they'll consider, I'm successful. This is the goal of life. But Prabhupada is telling, this is all illusory. Why? By this falsity, I do not mean to say that your so many friends were false to you, nor you are false to them. By this falsity, I mean illusion, or in other words, the false friendship and honors obtained thereby were but creation of Maya, and therefore they are always temporary or false, as you may call it. But none of you, neither your friends nor yourself, know this truth. So Prabhupada is calling this as Maya. It false friendships, false relationships. So this is mentioned by Sukadeva Goswami in the second canto, beginning verses, where he is calling the family as Asat Sena. Asat Sena. Asat Sena means false soldiers. So generally parents think that my children will protect me in the old age. And the children think that my parents will give me shelter. But actually, nobody can give shelter at any time. So that's why it's called Asat Sena. And during this COVID, we are realizing that if a child gets COVID, parents cannot even go near him. Even doctors don't touch him. They touch him with some instruments and with gowns and other things. So who is this? Who is our well-wisher? Who is our friend? So these are all false friendships. So Gandhi had so many friends before, but now everybody left him. Had great influential leaders who were with him, they all left him. He was alone, old and depressed. It's called Maya. Now by the grace of God, that illusion is going to be cleared. And thus, your faithful friends like Acharya Kripalini and others are accusing you for your inability at the present moment to give them any practical program of work as you happen to give them during your glorious days of non-cooperation movement. See, Gandhiji gave a lot of practical programs like salt satyagraha or Swadeshi movement, wearing only khadi dress, and even Prabhupada was wearing khadi at one point of time. And Gandhi topi, that became very famous. So non-cooperation movement, salt satyagraha, Swadeshi movement, so many things he started. So they're practical. But after independence, no practical program he could produce. They were all, he was helpless. He could not get any idea what to do now. Okay, now we have become independent. What to do now? There is no practical program. So you are also in a plight to find out proper solution for the present political tangle created by your opponents. Now Prabhupada is giving a suggestion here. You should therefore take a note of warning from your insignificant friend like me that unless you retire timely from politics and engage yourself 100% in the preaching work of Bhagavad Gita, which is the real function of Mahatmas, you shall have to meet with such inglorious deaths as Mussolini, Hitler, or Lloyd George met with. See, Hitler was, he committed suicide. Mussolini also died shot, I think so. And many leaders, you will see, political leaders, they are shot dead. Even our many prime ministers, some of them, even in American prime ministers, some of them are also shot, like Kennedy. He was going on a parade and then sniper shot him. In fact, he shot him in the head and brain burst out. So people who are attached to politics but not fixed in spirituality ultimately meet with the inglorious death. So it's like a prediction which Prabhupada is making here. I hope only Gandhi would have listened to this, then the shape of India would have been different. Right? So let's, Prabhupada is giving a practical program to Gandhi. In the next paragraph, you'll see. You can easily understand as to how some of your political enemies in the garb of friends, both Indian and English, have deliberately cheated you and have broken your heart by doing the same mischief for you, for which you have struggled so hard for so many years. You wanted chiefly Hindu-Muslim unity in India, and they have tactfully managed to undo your work by creation of Pakistan and India separately. You wanted freedom from India, but they have given permanent dependence of India. It's a very interesting statement. Actually, some devotees say that after independence, we became independently dependent on the West. Right? Although we got independence, but our ideology remained Western. Our aspirations remained Western. And our education system remained Western. So, there is no benefit of independence actually in one sense. Ideally, after independence, we should have gone back to our Vedic culture. That is meaning of independence. We should have again restarted our gurukuls, started our cow protections, natural living with cows and bulls. And we should have had a lot of sankirtans and teaching Gita and Bhagavatam. That should have been the real definition of independence. But some or the other, because of misdirected leaders, they could not give any solution to this. So Prabhupada writes further, you wanted to do something for the upliftment of the position of bhangis, but they are still rotting as bhangis, even though you are living in the bhangi colony. Bhangis means cleaners and like Shudra class people. They are all therefore illusions, and when these things will be presented to you as they are, you must consider them as God sent. God has favored you by dissipating the illusion you were hovering in. By the same illusion, you are nursing those ideas as truth. And Prabhupada says, so in Katha Upanishad, it is ordered that one must approach a bona fide guru who is not only well versed in all the scriptures of the world, but is also the realized soul of Brahman, the absolute, in order to learn the science of absolute truth. Okay. So you should approach a bona fide guru, tadviddhi pranipatena, pariprashnena, seve upadekshantite jnanam, jnanena, tattva darshina. So Prabhupada is telling him, now a real guru is coming to you, please accept this instructions and try to follow these instructions. But I know that you never underwent such transcendental teaching, except some severe penance which you invented for your purpose. As you have invented so many things in the course of experimenting with relative truths, you might have easily avoided them if you had approached the guru as above mentioned. Right? He invented satyagraha or fasting. He used to anything you want to do, fast. And when they see that you are about to die and so many people are supporting you, then they are forced to pass a resolution. Like after independence, India promised to pay about 500 crores to Pakistan. So, but they were not giving, and Gandhi started fasting. and then they were forced to give. So in this way, he used the fasting as a tool which is invented. Actually, tapasya is for, should be for spiritual awakening, not for political purpose. Tapo divyam putraka yena sattvam shuddhed. So that tapasya should be done which will purify the heart, not which will repay the loans or give us partitioning or such things. No. So he had a different wrong definition of tapasya, and he had invented it. In the last page of this letter, Prabhupada says, but you are sincere, what is that? So I'm not able to read. But your sincere efforts to attain some godly qualities by austerities, etc., surely have raised you to some higher platform, which you can better utilize for the purpose of absolute truth. If you, however, remain satisfied with such temporary position only, and do not try to know the absolute truth, then surely you will fall down from the artificially exalted position under the laws of nature. But if you want really to approach the absolute truth and want to do some real good to the people in general, all over the world, which shall include your ideas of unity, peace and non-violence, then you must give up the rotten politics immediately and rise up for the preaching work of philosophy and religion of Bhagavad Gita without offering unnecessary and dogmatic interpretation for them. And one of the interpretations Gandhi made was non-violence. Non-violence is the highest. But he didn't say that love for Krishna is the highest or chanting the holy names is the highest, but he was emphasizing on non-violence. That was the interpretation. I had occasionally discussed this subject in my paper back to audit, and a leaf from the same is enclosed here with for your reference. He is sending again back to audit with him. Now, I would only request you to retire from politics at least for 1 month and let us have discussion on Bhagavad Gita. I am sure thereby that you shall get a new light from the results of such discussions, not only for your benefit, but for the benefit of the world at large, as I know that you are sincere, honest and a moralist. Awaiting your early reply with interest, yours sincerely, Abhay Charan Te. So Prabhupada is calling Gandhi, come with me for one month at least. Come for 1 month and then let's have a discussion. But Gandhi did not reply. So this letter he wrote somewhere in September 1947, and he didn't get reply. And after a couple of months, in January 30th January, right, 1948, so Mahatma Gandhi was shot dead by people who were following him, and then he was gone. So this is in brief of this chapter called, of course there are many other things in this chapter, but this was the main theme, an unknown friend of Mahatma Gandhi. So where he is exposing the faults of politics and is encouraging everybody to take to Krishna consciousness. So later on in this chapter he writes to governor of Madras also, telling him that I have a plan to write 1200 a Bhagavad Gita with 1200 pages, kindly help me in publishing this copy, like that. And he writes to several other leaders also, expressing his desire to preach in the West and write many books on Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. And seeing his scholarship, some people will write to him also, saying that I have written a commentary of Bhagavad Gita. Can you please have a look at this? And Prabhupada once read one such book which was sent to him. And reading, he wrote a strong reply. I appreciate your interest in Bhagavad Gita and trying to understand Bhagavad Gita, but I see that your book is full of speculations and you have not even used one reference to the previous acharyas. You are quoting on your own and interpreting on your own. Such kind of book is not going to help you nor anybody. So kindly accept a spiritual master and try to read and understand from him and then write. So like that Prabhupada used to say. So in this way Prabhupada was constantly endeavoring to impress the leaders and literarians about this eagerness, about this urgency of Krishna consciousness. And this is almost 1947, and Prabhupada is about 50 plus years old, and he is about to enter into Vanaprastha Ashram very soon, and that incident of meority will come soon, very soon, and then Prabhupada even quits the home, and then he goes to Jhansi, and he goes to Vrindavan, and he starts preparing manuscripts of Bhagavatam, and finally he goes to America by ship. So one more instance is mentioned in this chapter, which is the dream which he had about Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati. So I'll just read that one statement about his dream. Let me check where it is. Actually, on one night, this year. So Prabhupada was in Allahabad with his son, and he had opened a short small factory, and then he had so Prabhupada had opened a small factory in Allahabad, and then he had tried to establish his business little bit there, because his Lucknow factory, which was big, had collapsed. So and in Allahabad he had the dream a second time. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati appeared before him. Again he was beckoning, indicating that Abhay should take sannyas, and again Abhay had to put the dream aside. He was a householder with many responsibilities. To take sannyas would mean to give up everything. He had to earn money. He had 5 children. Why is Guru Maharaj asking me to take sannyas? He thought. This was not possible now. So Srila Prabhupada, he had the desire, and Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati is calling him again and again. And finally in the 10th chapter of this first volume, he takes sannyas. The chapter name is Resident of Vrindavan, 9th chapter I think. So there again he gets a dream. And again he goes to his godbrother Bhakti Pragnan Kesha Maharaj, and Bhakti Pragnan Kesha Maharaj very eagerly says, yes, you must take sannyas. Immediately you take sannyas. I will give you sannyas. And you do preaching all over the world. So like this Bhakti Pragnan Maharaj called him in Mathura, and there he gave him sannyas, and he got the name Abhay Charan Arvind Bhakti Vedanta Swami. And then Prabhupada wrote first canto after taking sannyas. And then he published it, and then he got ready to preach in the West. So in essence, this is the chapter summary. Of course, there are many other details, but due to lack of time, I pause here.